from Brooklyn, New York. Graffiti, decoration for anti-gentrification. It's Arts Insight with Andrew Gadoni. Tonight, attorney and stand-up comedian Alex Barnett, plus musicians Gennaro Kravitz and Mike Leiden.
Welcome to Arts Insight. I'm Andrew. Here on Arts Insight, we feature some of New York's finest neighborhood talent from all five boroughs of New York City, as we've been doing for the last 20 years. And God, I feel like an old man. Liz, how are you?
I'm doing great. It's kind of fun to be in Red Hook. It's near the Bay of O'Connell, as people are calling the Red Hook waterfront these days.
And as I call, whenever I go, of course, to Fairway, I'm sure to get my cream of O'Connell. Very tasty soup. Have you tried it?
I have tried.
I mean, it's great to be here in the confines of the Brooklyn Waterfront Artists Coalition. Make no mistake of it. It's our new home, certainly, and I'm glad it's our second show, and we have a very exciting lineup tonight. So I'm excited to introduce tonight's first guest. This is an interesting combination. He's a native Brooklynite now living on the Upper West Side. He's an attorney by day and a stand-up comedian by night. He's an accomplished stand-up comedian who's been seen at comedy clubs at Catch a Rising Star, the Gotham Comedy Club, and Stand Up New York. He is also an accomplished writer who chronicles his comedy career in a regular column in the Daily News Money section. A proud Ivy League grad, brand new dad, and we're sure he's got a lot to share with our neighborhood viewers. Please welcome tonight to the show, Alex Barnett.
Thank you. Thank you so much. You know, they'll tell you that the first date really sets the tone for the relationship. It's true. Like, on my first date with my wife, she looked across the table and she said, "Listen, just so you know, I'm looking for a guy to marry." I was like, "You know what? That's beautiful. I will date you while you keep looking." Yeah. I don't know why she wanted to marry me. I thought women want a guy with a steady job, right? I've had 8 jobs since college. I've been fired from 7 of them. Not joking, my business card now is just a picture of my mother weeping uncontrollably. And I thought women want a big guy, you know, someone to protect him. Who's gonna protect me? Look at me, I'm short, like I've never seen a parade live. The point is, it's hard to feel like a man in today's world. Try doing it when you're my height. I was in a club not long ago with my wife, some of her friends, surrounded by beautiful women, and I thought, okay, not that big a deal. Next thing I know, one of them turns up, picks me up, starts swinging on. She's like, "Oh, you're so cute. She's so lucky." My feet swinging across the floor like this. Like, first of all, where was this chick when I was trying to see the parade? Second of all, I'm a man. I have a bar mitzvah certificate that says, "You are a man." Actually, it says, "You are a man." By the way, my wife is black, and even in today's era, people get weird about interracial dating. Like, not every day, but I have buddies, white guys, come up to me like, "Dude, what's with the black woman?" And I'm like, "I don't know, because black guys don't do it for me." It's true, though. People have a hard time getting their arms around this relationship. Like, how can this black woman be with this white guy unless there's this, like, complicated backstory? Like, she's an R&B singer, and I'm her agent. Truth is, I was intimidated when I first met her family, because her brother's like 6'6". He played college ball. He's black, too. And but we're doing very well. My wife actually converted to Judaism, which is huge. But her family didn't, and they're Christian. So to make them feel more comfortable at our home during the holidays, we've modified our services so they'll feel at ease. So like for Passover, our Seder goes as follows. When we were slaves in Egypt, and parts of the southern United States. Moses and Dr. King said, "Let my people go." When they refused, God and the NAACP set forth a torrent of plagues and lawsuits. And the people went out, and they roamed for years till they found a homeland, a place where they could be free and enjoy self-determination. I speak, of course, of the land of Brooklyn. Where blacks and Jews roam free even to this day. Now, we're very excited, my wife and I, because we just had a baby 4 weeks ago. And thank you, thank you. And thank you. Now, it's interesting, when you tell people you're having a child, the first thing they want to know is, what's the gender? And my wife didn't want to know. She wanted to be surprised. I'm like, what kind of surprise? It's a boy or it's a girl. There are no other choices. It's not like the doctor be like, ta-da, it's a penguin. Right? Although, because she's black and I'm white. Possibly. Then the second thing we had to figure out was the name, because a name is very important. And, you know, I have a buddy who said, just name it after your favorite parent. I was like, man, I'm not having a son named Mommy. Besides, in the Jewish tradition, we don't name children after living relatives, because there's a superstition that when the older person dies and God comes to collect the soul, God could get confused. The all-knowing, all-powerful creator of everything might not be able to tell the difference between the bundle of joy and a 90-year-old man who won't stop talking about the Great Depression. Now, I realize they're both bald and toothless. Have you ever smelled an old man? That's not new baby smell. Here's another difference. When babies go missing, people get upset. I've never seen old man's picture on the back of a milk carton. I mean, old man goes missing, people are like, well, what's his time? Now, the truth is, when people found out we're having kids, some people got upset. They're like, mixing is bad, right? Now, these same people have no problem mixing dogs. Like, they'll mix a German Shepherd with a Chihuahua just to see what happens. Tell you what happens, you get a Nazi with a quick Latin temper. Truth is, I am worried about being the white dad of black kids. My last name is Barnett. What if my biracial son comes to me one day for advice? He says, Dad, listen, the last time a white man named Barnett had anything to do with black people, it was 1962, the governor of Mississippi told James Meredith he couldn't go to college because he was black. Is that what you're going to do? You're going to stop me from going to college because I'm black? Be like, of course not. Stop you from going to college because it's expensive. You want to go to college, when that financial aid form comes, you check that box marked black. All right, guys, thanks so very much. You've been terrific.
Welcome to the show, Alex Barnett.
Thank you, thank you.
Pleasure to have you on the show.
Thank you, it's a pleasure being here.
So tell us a little bit about your day job as an attorney.
Currently I work as a contract attorney for the city of New York during the day. And at night, as you know, I'm a comic performing all over the country. And that's much more enjoyable than the day job. So that's what I'm trying to do. That's what I'm trying to transition into, yeah.
It just seems like an interesting combination, and you know, far be it for me to say this, but I notice that when I go to a nightclub or I go to a place of entertainment, it always seems like the fun bunch are always the attorneys. And I seem to think there's some sort of correlation there, but I don't know.
Wow. I don't know. I think you just flattered a lot of lawyers who probably didn't deserve it. But I think partly is because law is such a high stress profession that when you see people are out, it means they're really getting drunk and or doing illegal substances, and that therefore they're having fun. But if you see them at their job, they're not really having that much fun. I think that's probably the correlation you're seeing. So,
I see.
Yeah.
Do you find humor, anything funny about your work?
I do have some material about being a lawyer and going to law school and the perils and pitfalls of being an attorney and practicing law, but the bulk of my material is about my relationship with my wife and our new baby and living in New York and that kind of thing, yeah.
When did you catch the bug to be a comedian?
Oh, must have been 6-7 years ago, I guess. I was writing short stories and attempting to write a novel to get published and took a couple acting classes, and I think just all this stuff sort of snowballed on itself and led me to pursue comedy, which is sort of the confluence of acting and writing.
Being an attorney, I know you're not a litigation attorney per se, are you?
Well, no, I am. That's what I did my entire career is litigation, yes.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, I obviously didn't do my research. Attorney joke. But I'm kind of wondering, you know, if you have a judge that you need to persuade, or like, I mean, if you ever face a jury, I mean, how do you think there's any value in comedy when it comes to buttering them up?
Yeah, there is. There is, I'm sure. I mean, because at its base, comedy is about communicating ideas and emotions and attitudes. And that's true. And that those skills apply in all kinds of different careers and industries and professions. So if you're in front of a jury and you need to persuade them, it's no different at some level from persuading an audience. So it is helpful at that level, yeah.
Because I could just imagine there's just so much tension in that room. Usually court's a very tense place because a decision about someone or something's future is being made. And I mean, one way to sort of disperse that kind of tension could be comedy.
Yeah, I mean, but you have to, I mean...
To backfire on you too.
Could, I mean, I was gonna say, to forgive the pun, but you have to use it judiciously, because if you come across as being sort of a wise guy, you know, judges and jury members don't really care for that. But, you know, I think, look, everybody needs a little comedy and levity in their lives. So a little bit sprinkled here and there is always worthwhile, sure.
You do write a column in the Daily News,
yep.
In the money section.
Yep.
I hate to admit I'm not a frequent reader of that particular publication. Nothing wrong with that. Occasionally I do for all the juicy bits and stuff.
Yeah.
But tell us about your column.
It's a very exciting opportunity. I basically just write about the transition in my career from law to comedy. And strangely enough, I've had a number of people come up to me and say they actually read it, which is great. Both comics, lawyers, and actually I shouldn't say both, lawyers, comics, and people who are neither, who've said, yeah, I read it, it was really interesting. I really found it... it resonated with me because I'm going through a career transition, or I want to go through a career transition, or I'm thinking about a career transition, and this has helped me sort of sort through my thoughts. So that's really rewarding when you actually have people come up to you like that.
Sure,
yeah.
Sure. It's perhaps gives them a little hope or influence, or, you know, at least
yeah.
gives them sort of a legend for how one may pursue a changeover in career like you, you know.
That's right. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, you're a new father. Congratulations.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Yeah, very exciting. Very exciting.
Do you mind delving a little bit into family life for us?
Sure.
You did in your act.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. No, it's great. We had a baby 4.5 weeks ago, almost 5 weeks ago. His name's Ivan. It's great. All the cliches you hear about fatherhood and parenthood are absolutely true. It's the best thing I ever did, by far. Most exhausting thing I ever did, by far. I don't sleep. My wife sleeps less. But it's, I would give up everything else in my life to be a dad. And it's the best. It's wow. Absolutely the best.
Again, congratulations.
Thank you. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, it's enough of a, you know, your comedy can be your baby.
Yeah.
And now this. I hear the same thing from new dads all the time, and new parents in general.
Yeah.
No sleep, ever.
No, that's definitely true. There's no sleep, no sleep. At least no contiguous sleep.
So where do you find time to continue the good work on the comedy circuit? Your schedule looks top to bottom busy, so, I mean, you must be doing something right.
Thank you. I mean, knock wood, I've been pretty fortunate, but you just have to make things fit. You have to just... I stay up later, I squeeze things in, I sleep less, so that's fine. I'm up anyway, so I'm working then. And, you know, it's that old cliche that if you want something done, you give it to the busy person, right? So I'm the busy person now, and I seem to get a lot of stuff done for somehow. Although I don't remember any of it because I'm half asleep when I'm doing it.
Well, you organize your time better. You're almost forced to now.
Yeah, absolutely. You have to prioritize your time.
So, on the note of comedy circuit, how is it like to face an audience? In your words, like, we know the hecklers and the jokesters mm-hmm. and the people who make up their own comedy while at your comedy show. What's that experience been like? How does it motivate you? Am I asking too many questions?
No. Those are good questions. The truth of the matter is, you don't get that many hecklers. At least I haven't. By and large, crowds are very excited people who want to be there. They paid money to be there. They want to be entertained. They want to laugh. If you treat them with respect, as you would any other people you meet, they give you the love and support back because they want to be there. They want you to entertain them. So nine and a half times out of 10, the audiences are great. Every so often, there's a dynamic in the room that is a little off kilter. But, if you're good at what you do as a comic and you've got some experience, you can handle that too. And there's a certain level of challenge and interest in doing that, doing it successfully. So, but that's not that often at all. Yeah.
I'm glad it's been, mostly happy roads for you.
Yeah, absolutely.
Happy trails, that is. Screwing up my idioms already. If we want to check out your regular schedule, of course, if we go to your website.
Right.
That's alexbarnettcomic.com, as you see on your screen.
That's right.
Dial into or log on to the website, and you'll see when Alex is performing next. Well, it's great to have you on the show.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you. Really
so much,
appreciate
Alex.
It. Thank you.
Alex
thank
Barnett,
you.
Everybody.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
We'll be right back.
All right.
Welcome back to Arts Insight. And if you're just tuning in, you missed a wonderful guest by the name of comedian Alex Barnett, attorney and stand-up comedian Alex Barnett.
That's great, because if you have a law case, you have comedy, you have law, and you have comic relief at the right moment.
Right. He knows how to butter up the judges.
Right.
I mean, what better than to have an attorney with a sense of humor?
Right.
Of course,
play with the jury.
In legal proceedings, however, that might not always be appropriate, but it's always worth a shot. You got to get the jury on your side. You got to get the judge on your side.
You want that.
You make them laugh a little bit, right?
Exactly.
Especially if, you murdered a couple guys. Hey, let the guy off the hook. I mean, he's been through a lot. His mental space is not quite right. I mean, he's...
You're out of your mind.
Yeah. Well, you're out of your gourd too, lady.
You're out of your gourd.
Well, if you're just tuning in, certainly you're not out of luck just yet. Our second guests tonight are no strangers to this show, and occasionally we like to invite guests from the past who've made their mark in the neighborhood world of community arts in the five boroughs. Oof, that was a mouthful. This duo has been offering their unique brand of swing jazz for the last decade, and the singer is a native Brooklynite from Fort Greene whose career as a jazz singer and entertainer has spanned more than four decades, playing places like the Village Corner and Webster Hall. And the second part to this group, the guitarist, is an accomplished music journalist, author, writer, and longtime East Village resident who has interviewed legends of rock and roll, Motown, jazz, and blues, and you name it. He's also the founding editor of Rolling Stone magazine. How about that? Truly an honor to have this duo back. Please welcome to the show Gennaro Kravitz and Michael Lydon.
Many cigarettes, a glass of flat champagne, your wilted violets, that's Paris in the rain. We crossed the Pont des Arts, a blind man tapped his cane, the river swift and dark, of Paris in the rain. How can days become weeks, become months, lost in years? How can love that was true, that was real, disappear? You told me not to cry. You'd write from sunny Spain. Au revoir is not goodbye. Of Paris in the rain. Too many cigarettes, a glass of flat champagne, your wilted violets, that's Paris in the rain. How can days become weeks, become months, lost in years? How can love that was true, that was real, disappear. You told me not to cry. You'd write from sunny Spain. Au revoir is not goodbye. That's Paris in the rain. Paris in the rain. Paris in the rain. Paris in the rain.
Toddle off to bed.
Life like this is halfway dead. Life like this is halfway dead. Life like this is halfway dead.
What can I say? Another great show. And certainly if you have questions, comments, or a guest recommendation for our program, feel free to reach us at the Arts Insight Hotline. The number is on your screen right here. Or maybe you want to send us an email instead. Just know our new address. It is artsinsightshow@gmail.com. Question, comments, anything you want to
questions,
add.
Questions, comments, no criticisms.
Yeah, don't comment on Liz's very, very bizarre behavior. We don't need any mail about that. But thank you for watching, and make it a good one. I'll see you next week, and so will Liz.